Well, howdy there and welcome to yet another episode of Live at Leigh's Place. I'm your host, Leigh McRae, the creator of the Vocal Mastery program, which you can get at vocalmastery.com. And a big shout out to our good friends at Rode Microphones who have given us these fantastic microphones. I'm absolutely thrilled today to have a very, very dear friend of mine, someone who I've not seen for a few years because she's living overseas, and we're going to discuss all of that with her in just a moment. Please say hello to my very, very good friend, Kellie Gnauck, all the way from London, England.
Hooray.
Hey, hear that applause out there?
The crowd goes wild.
People are going crazy out there. Kellie, thank you so much for coming along, because I know that you're home just for a very, very brief period of time, and the fact that you've contacted me and want to come and see, I'm putting the words dear and old together, dear old singing teacher, but we'll keep the dear part.
Sure.
I'm so thrilled to bits. I haven't seen you for a few years, and you have just been doing some fantastic things, which we're going to get into as we go along. What's it been like to come back and say hi to the folks?
It's been lovely. I've been really lucky with the weather, which I'm thrilled about.
Yes.
But yeah, it's been... Actually, I was here last year, so it hasn't been as long as...
I missed you on that one.
Yeah,
We couldn't make it happen.
Like 8 days I was here for last year. But before that, it had been 3 years, which is mad.
My Lord. Well, it's almost 3 years since I saw you in London, which we were just chatting about before. And what a turnaround, because at the time... You were working in a theatre, but not as a theatre performer.
Yeah.
And you so graciously looked after my wife and I when we went to see...
Wicked.
That green show, I call
that
it.
Green
yes.
One, yep.
The thing with the green people, yes.
Mm-hmm.
So we might talk about that, because that's an interesting thing for our listeners and viewers. Mm-hmm. So I'm going to say readers. We don't have any readers. Well, maybe we do. Our listeners and viewers who are very, very interested in the stories of what's going on for folks with their... you know, I hate the word journey, because it sounds like The Voice or something, right? But it's a really, really important part of what happens.
Yeah.
Firstly, let's just talk a little bit about I kind of guess where it started for you, insofar as your education and the sort of things that you were doing prior to, darest I use the expression, before you got serious, you know, for want of a better term. Tell us a little bit about your upbringing so far as musical theatre and things like that.
So I actually went to a performing arts school up in Newcastle, Broadmeadow.
Mm-hmm.
What was it called? Hunter School of the Performing Arts.
Right.
I think it might just be Broadmeadow now.
Right.
I think you had to audition to get in, and it was music, acting or dance. Obviously I did music.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that was a nice environment to start with. I've always done dance lessons, always done singing lessons, piano, drums, the lot. I was doing like 12 dance lessons a week.
Oh, my Lord.
And I'm not even a dancer. Like, that was just...
Oh, I don't
I dance,
know about
but
that.
It's not,
I've seen you dance.
It's
certainly...
not like... I'll never be in the Royal Ballet or anything. Let's not get too
that
excited.
That makes two of us, I think.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I started with that. Then I auditioned for... I think I auditioned for a couple of schools, Whopper being one of them.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think I auditioned. What's the one in Sydney?
NIDA.
I don't think I auditioned for NIDA.
Right.
And then ED5 was the other one, which was also in Sydney.
Yes. And now you're, I was looking at the list of guests we've had on the podcast so far, and I think you are the fourth person that I've had on who has had an ED5
really?
Background. So I'm thinking I should start getting some sort of, or maybe financial, you know, remuneration there from ED5. William might still be there.
I think he is.
I think he's the boss man. William.
Boss man. They
Let
still do, what is it? They've got a hashtag. I think it's hashtag I went to ED5.
Oh, there you go.
To keep them updated.
The other guests that I've had on, and of course I've had a number of students here over the years that have gone to that school. The one thing that they all seem to have, say in common, is the best way to put it, is how... disciplined, yeah, or how disciplined they had to become. So where that, you know, you've got to turn up 5 days a week, you've got to know your stuff. So I'm guessing you were in, because they have two streams, they have like the singing dancing stream, don't they?
Yeah,
call it that.
I think it might be different now. I think they do slightly different courses, but when I went however many years ago, there was a dance intensive or a vocal intensive.
Yes.
And you did everything in both of them, but the focus was on one or the other. So I did the vocal intensive, and there was only like maybe not even 12 people in the course, which was amazing because there was so much private tutoring, which is what I think is the most helpful.
Right.
So we obviously focused on music and acting. We still had to do 8 a.m. every morning, whether it was cardio, running around the block, or whether it was, I think they would set up, Craig was one of the teachers, and he would set up these like circuits. So everyone had to do that, dancers, singers, whoever you were. And then we still had to do ballet. We still had to do all the dance classes, but our focus was obviously music.
Mm. Somebody said to me recently, who someone I'm working with who graduated from there a couple of years ago, they alluded to the fact that it was the message was pushed home that if you can get this discipline going, this is probably about as difficult as it would be. Now, would you say that that's a reasonable thing, given that you've been in professional shows now and that you've...
Yeah, I think being at college, or what do we call it here, university?
Well, college is good enough, yeah.
Mm-hmm. It's such a different experience to, I'll say, the real world. It's,
yes.
Yeah, for lack of a better term. They're just completely different things.
Mm.
So I do think if you can get through the 8 till 4, I think it is, 5 days a week, then like 8 shows a week should be nothing.
Right.
Should be.
Should be,
as long as you've got the foundation in place,
mm-hmm.
that's, I think that's harder than 8 shows a week.
Good. With regard to then going to an educational institution like that and that kind of discipline, clearly there's a big step up from... and I say with utmost respect, you know, local dance school, you know, suburban dance school, to that, and then going into the profession. And out of that, when you graduated, memory serves me correctly, you went to Japan for 2 years, I think.
Yeah, I was contracted for 1 year, but I loved it so much that I stayed for a second.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, my first year I did, it was called the Hello Kitty Show, which was an outdoor... We were like on a bus that would drive in, stop, we'd do the show, we'd drive out. And then the second year I stayed on as their swing, so, well, their female swing, and I covered, I think I had about 12 roles that I covered throughout the park. But that for me, like, I think you can learn to swing, but some people are just born with that kind of mindset. That works for me. It keeps me occupied. I like the challenge of it. That was really good for me. That was probably the hardest job I've done.
Yeah, I can concur with that. I've been offered swing parts and I've said, no, thank you.
It's just
too much work.
I love it.
Well, good for you. I'm glad you enjoyed that. So for folks, once again, well, I keep addressing folks that are they're watching. They already know they're watching, don't they? Yes. That could involve, if you're on a plot of a show and there are, say, 10 female characters, you would need to know all of their bits, all of the 10 parts, plus all the plots as well, which includes props.
Yeah, all the backstage changes.
All the backstage changes. It really is quite an involved job. You might only have one solo line there.
Yeah.
And you might walk up to a person with a beer stein. And I mean, there's silly things.
Yeah.
But it has to work.
Mm-hmm.
And just explain the kind of notice you would get if you're going on as a swing.
Oh, I've had anything from a week's notice to... someone's fallen over in the number we've just done for the next scene. You have to go on.
There you go.
And do that.
That's
like
extraordinary.
It ranges. It's mad.
Yeah. So, by the way, this was at Universal Studios, I think, in Japan.
Yeah.
And same thing. It's a similar pattern. I've had two other guests on who both have kind of followed you that role, I suppose. And they both expressed... for one of them, it was their first time away. I got a feeling for you, it was probably your first time living away from home. Is that right?
Yeah. During ED5, I lived, because I'm from the Central Coast originally.
Yes.
And obviously ED5 is, what suburb is that?
Strathfield, I think.
Yes.
So Kellie's family home is about an hour and a half north of the heart of Sydney.
Yeah.
And where Strathfield is, probably 30 minutes from the heart of Sydney. So you were living... in Sydney, weren't you?
I was living in Summerhill.
Lovely.
Couldn't tell you where that is now, but...
it's over there. Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice part of the world. So, but then literally going overseas at... were you 19,
I was
perhaps?
9...
20, maybe?
I was 19 turning 20 the first year,
You know, doesn't sound like a big deal, but it is. It's the
it's
reality.
A big it's not like moving to the States or something where everything is the same, everyone speaks the same language.
Mm.
It was moving to... a country where everything is different. Like,
yeah. And I believe the fandom is quite something.
Yeah, they love it.
Yeah. There are people who come back repeatedly and they film the show over and over and over.
Every day.
Yeah. Quite extraordinary.
I had people there every single show.
And I also know that the, if the right word is, the quality control is very high as well, right?
Yeah.
Because it's a branded thing.
Yeah.
It's a Disney brand, isn't it? And so
I don't think they're quite adamant. Disney's a whole other level, I think.
Right.
But there's still very much, there's no backstage photos. There's none of that.
Right.
You can't talk about the company outside of it.
Wow.
Because you're meant to be portraying this character and they don't want to kind of ruin that.
Hmm. It that sort of forces you to have to, I'm going to say for want of a better term, you have to get better. Well,
yeah.
That's not a guarantee, but the mere fact that you are singing sometimes four and five, six shows a day.
Six shows a day.
You know, for 5 or 6 days a week, one would hope you'd get better.
Yeah.
Look, the truth is I've never seen anyone who's come back from those things. And we used to have one here in Australia called Wonderland, which is gone. It's a little bit same sort of theme parky thing. And I've not seen anybody yet who hasn't improved as a result of going doing that for
even just
for
stamina.
6 months. Well, there's a big part of it right there, isn't it?
Yeah, because I was doing, on my second year for swing, I was doing up to 16-hour days.
Right.
Which is madness when you think about in the professional industry that I'm used to now. You maybe work 3 hours on a matinee day. Obviously it's double that, but if you're just doing a one you know Thursday Friday night, 3 hours of work.
Incredible. That's phenomenal.
Yeah.
So the one of the I guess repeated questions on emails I get because of this course or these series of podcasts is people want to know more and more about education, and the education, I guess, varies depending on what discipline you're in, but the necessity of ongoing education is essential. Would you concur with that?
Yeah, absolutely.
But I would like to ask you what you some of the favourite things, or maybe them, actually they may not be favourite, but things that have really encouraged you or even forced you to go to the next level.
Yeah.
Vocally, acting wise, anything in particular you can share with us?
Acting wise, I think should we start on Evita?
Sure. Well, I was going to get to that soon.
Oh, okay.
I didn't want to peek too early, but please. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, acting wise, I was, because obviously I started out in Evita as a cover. So I was 8 shows a week. I was an ensemble. And I was second cover. So it was kind of always said that I wouldn't go on because you've got the person playing the role, the first cover, or we had an alternate, and then me. So there's not really, something drastic would have to happen for me to go on. So I never really rehearsed in the part. I learned the music, but I never had any direction or anything like that. And then I want to say maybe 12 weeks into the run, our lead girl, who was playing Evita, Emma Hatton, she's incredible. She had, I want to say, laryngitis.
Right.
Then, so our alternate had been doing 8 shows a week. She then got sick as well.
Right.
And we'd gone out the night before, and I'm not a big drinker as it is because I can't sing after I drink.
No.
It's just not for me. But it's
good advice out there, folks.
Well, some people can do it. I just can't.
Not too many that I've met, you know.
People like Jimmy Barnes, I'm sure, would be great.
Yes.
But for me, it's just not what I'm good at. So we'd gone out the night before until like 4 or 5 in the morning. And I woke up the next morning, I was at the gym, and I got a call at about, I want to say 11:30 from our company manager saying, so Emma's obviously still off because she has laryngitis. Natalie has lost her voice. And she didn't have to say any more and just, you know when everything goes hot when you're in full panic mode?
Yeah.
So obviously I had to go on that night. Music-wise, I wasn't that worried, but I had never run the show with the cast.
Oh my Lord.
I'd never had any direction. It was a case of, can you get on and off at the right times and sing at the right times, yes or no? I said, probably. That acting-wise, that was the biggest, I didn't have a choice, the only option was to do it. And I think I learned so much from having to do that because there was no time to sit there and prepare mentally and be like, okay, so what am I thinking about in this scene? There was none of that. It was a case of just being, which is sounds wanky, but in acting class, they teach you not to act, to just be.
Right.
So I had to do that. There was no, oh, well, I think I'm going to feel this way. I didn't get to do that. So that's, I think acting-wise, that was my biggest step up.
Mm, dearie me. That's as a fellow actor and performer, that's terrifying. Almost frightening to me.
Yeah. I was in tears when they told me. I was like, please, no.
I find that extraordinary that in, you know, a production with that kind of, well, at the very minimum, financial backing.
Yeah, I know.
That they're not rehearsing all the way down. Now, that wouldn't be common, but
no.
I've heard of it before.
Yeah. I had, so grateful for everyone I had backstage. The cast were amazing and so supportive just making it work, to the point where the sound guy, because Evita's sung through, there's no dialogue.
Mm-hmm.
But the role of Evita sings the whole show. It's quite a large role to go on for.
Oh, my goodness,
and to the point where the sound guy, anytime I wasn't singing, he had my mic off so people could come up to me and say, you need to walk over there, or your next part's over there. And then I had backstage, I had someone walking around with my score. So every time I came off stage, I could see where I was at. Someone standing there waving at me to be like, this is the way you come off. I had obviously someone to do my wigs, because I'd never practiced wig changes, costume changes. And that role, you don't get to go back to your dressing room. If you're not on stage, you're changing.
Mm, you're in the wing, yeah.
I had five people. I even had a poor boy holding a water bottle. That was his job for the night.
Mm-hmm.
Just holding a water bottle.
Yeah.
It was the most amazing thing I've ever done.
I know that feeling there when I was doing Les Mis, that's the first change when you go from the prisoner to the mayor.
Yeah.
And you run into the wing and there are six people and each of those people have a job and you basically you just stand. Right, you know the feeling. You stand even to the point that someone just puts a straw in your mouth and you sip water.
Yeah.
Somebody's putting some grey in your hair. Somebody's taking off the rags, the makeup, putting the morning jacket on, the whole bit.
Mm-hmm.
And if it's not done with precision, you'll pretty much miss the next cue. And there were times where we were that short on it, that would literally go on to do the scene in the factory because Valjean comes back in and he just says, I look to you to sort this out. He's on for a minute maybe, that I would have dirt on this side of my face still, no grey in that side of the head. Like literally it would be, it was just cheating the whole thing.
Yeah.
And then you'd have a break then. And those experiences, well, they sound like fun, but...
I thrive off them. I'm
glad
hilarious.
You do, because I've actually got anxiety even talking about it. And the last time I had that particular experience was nearly 25 years ago. And when I think about it now, it gives me a cold shiver.
Oh, I've done it where they couldn't get the zip on that first show.
Right.
They couldn't get the zip of one of my... It's like she wears like a pencil skirt and this little jacket that does up at the back. And literally, she walks from one side to the other. She sings a line as she does it, but that's all she does. And I had to cheat the whole thing facing the front because my jacket wasn't done up. I was like, okay.
And let's add to this, sing with incredible veracity. I think what we're going to do, we're going to take a little break here. We're going to come back and talk about the vocal demands of that role.
Sure.
We'll be back in just a moment.
You're tuned in to Live at Leigh's Place, where we talk to singers about singing stuff. Proudly presented by vocalmastery.com. where there's never been a better time to become a great singer.
And we're back. Just before the break, we were discussing there with Kellie about going on, like literally with, a few hours' notice to play the role of Evita. And then you went into a tour,
mm-hmm.
which was the UK and to Italy.
Yes.
You then moved up to the first cover, which meant that you did primarily the matinees.
Yeah, so we had Wednesday and Thursday matinees and obviously the normal Saturday as well, which mm-hmm. then meant we had Sunday and Mondays off.
Right.
Which is quite lovely. That's
lovely. Yes, very nice. Yeah. Very nice. So to folks who may be not familiar with musical theatre jargon, the matinee is usually the 2 p.m. show.
Mm-hmm.
And traditionally, usually, within a month or two after opening, the lead character or the lead role person will be given the matinees off as a way of resting their voice and whatnot. In some shows, it's written in there, in the Frankie Valli, what's that called?
Jersey Boys.
There's an alternate.
He always has an alternate.
I think in Wicked, there's definitely an alternate Elphaba,
and I'm pretty sure Glinda now as well have, they definitely have standbys.
Right.
So that's someone that literally sits in their dressing room until they go on for that part.
Extraordinary, isn't it? And that you got to do that role, and then the role of Peron was taken over by a mutual friend of ours, but a friend of mine for more than 25 years, a guy named Jeremy Seacom, who has done remarkably well.
Yeah.
Who he and I were in production of Les Mis nearly 25 years ago. So that's how long ago that was. He's a great guy. He's a fan, and he's done phenomenally well there.
He's amazing as well, both on and off stage, which is a big thing.
He's a great guy. He's what we still call a bloke.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
he's also
is.
Got this this, and I haven't had a crack at you yet. Well, I did when you came in. This quasi London accent.
He's still got his Aussie accent.
Oh,
I think.
He sounds but he still does it a little bit. I talked to him, you know. But look, it's unavoidable, I suppose, isn't it? It's part and parcel.
Well, I hadn't told you this. I had dialect lessons when I moved there.
Yes.
So they're lessons to, I guess it could be accent coaching, depending on what you want to call it. And originally I had them purely to learn the accent. So if I needed to use it for scripts or for whatever.
Yes.
But then I've always been quite a mimicker anyway.
Mm-hmm.
So I think once I had learned how to make the correct sounds, then being surrounded by the accent, now I can't get rid of it.
Yes.
Like I'm just stuck with this accent now.
Can't give me an Aussie accent anymore?
Well, I actually did. I do a bit of presenting work on the side, and I did a presenting job at the end of last year where they needed me to be Australian.
Right.
And I had Home and Away playing in my ear because I couldn't remember the accent and I was surrounded by British people.
Yes.
So in between takes, I would just have to sit and listen to Alf Stewart or someone. Yeah.
Well, that is an Aussie accent. So I digress for there, but so you're with Jeremy, and the amazing thing, and I tell this story on a regular basis about you and Jeremy, and that is that both of these guys come from small towns. You're from
Jillaby.
There you go.
Where is that? Nobody
it's
knows.
Up that way. a population, approximately?
Oh, maybe 1,000, not even.
There you go. And Jeremy is from a place called Crookwell, which is on the way to Canberra, which is well known in Australia. The point to be made is, and I never try and sugarcoat this. It's a disservice to say to people, oh, you can be anything you want. No, you can have a go at things if you have the right training.
Mm-hmm.
Put yourself in the right environment. You'll need a bit of luck, right? But you
have
to be ready.
Yep.
You have to be ready. So we don't want to give naive statements to people. I'll just believe and it will happen. That's only part of it, right?
Yeah.
There's a lot of stuff, but these guys and many, many other expats there are living proof of what can be done. And I want to talk a little bit more about that, but I'm really curious about the attraction to going to London in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
Was it a case that you didn't think you could have a career here?
I think, I'm going to say this, but it has changed since I've left. When I was here, though, there wasn't a big industry for musical theatre. I think there was maybe, 3 or 4 shows happening.
Well, that's still the case, though.
It's gotten a little bit better, but it just, I think there was one casting director at the time. There's not a lot of opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas places like New York and London, you've got the hub for it. You've got Broadway, the West End. So for me, that was a no-brainer. I'm lucky that I've got dual citizenship, so I can live there. And even when London's great because there's so many shows happening at the one time, but there's also a lot of other things you can do outside of that when you're not specifically in a show, which I think that was the draw for me, because here, I don't even know what the case would be. If you're not in a show, what's your in-between job? Whereas there's so many things that are still related to the industry.
If you're a singer, and if you're a singer that can play the piano even better, then you can make a living without question. But even if you're a singer, you can do a cabaret show, but there's not a lot of work for it. You're not going to be working 3 or 4 nights a week doing that. The current sort of in-between thing most of the folks are doing is ship work, which I know you did as well, right? You did it out of the UK, I think.
I've done one out of the UK, one out of Miami.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, there's in-between stuff for folks to do. But back to this tour. So you now step up as being the first cover.
Yes. You're
doing the matinees. What did that do for you in terms of your confidence? And also, what did it do for your voice? Because I'm really interested to hear what changed there as well.
So in the terms of confidence, and I think acting-wise, it gave me so much more presence on stage.
Mm-hmm.
When I was second cover, it's kind of known for covers, I think, that when you go on, you are kind of expected to do a similar show to what the lead would be doing.
Yes.
Which makes complete sense. I'm all for that. So then when I got to go and do it two, maybe three times a week, I got to give my version of the show.
Mm.
I mean, within reason, you can't change things.
Yes, true.
But I got to create a character rather than copy a character.
Good for you.
So that was amazing for confidence and for acting.
Mm.
And again, I never got any direction, even when I was doing...
That's extraordinary.
Yeah. That's not normal.
That was not normal. You weren't getting, like, I can remember even, like 3 weeks into a run, still getting notes under the door.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, don't put your hand in your pocket and make sure
I would have loved that.
You know, all that sort of, you've probably had that in other circumstances, right?
I was getting notes for vocal things because we did have an MD, right. Obviously, mm-hmm. who was conducting the show, but we didn't have a resident director. That's right. Why I wasn't getting any of that sort of stuff. But vocally, I think this... The role specifically, you use your whole range. It's not a role like Elphaba where you are just constantly in your mezzo range or just constantly belting. Eva has some really low stuff, some soprano stuff, and then obviously she's got her belt stuff as well.
Yeah.
So I was kind of a bit of an overachiever with it. I only performed the show twice, maybe three times a week, but I sung the show about six times a week.
Right.
So I would do it in my own time. I would turn up to the theatre early. People got so bored of it. They were like, Kellie, why are you still singing these songs? You know them.
Mm.
But it was to keep it in my voice because when I wasn't on for that part, my ensemble track was Soprano 1, which is
way up in the
heavens. And that's a completely different voice type to what Eva is.
Yeah. There's a great bit of advice you're giving here, Kellie, without maybe even realising it. When I have somebody preparing for a role, and what I've done when I've, back in the day, I've got to say now, is that I would build up my stamina and then I would sing the role two times per day.
Yeah.
So I'd get used to comfortably being able to do a matinee in an evening. And I just do it, and I would do that every day.
Yeah.
Until we got into rehearsals, where, of course, you're using your voice a lot. And then once you're in a run of eight shows a week, you don't want to sing those songs anymore. You've had, and it just, the best thing I can say to you is it fits, doesn't it? It just fits in the mouth at that point. It's like a good fitting pair of shoes. But until you get it to that point, and to me, three times a week would not be enough for that.
Well, no, there's such a difference between someone who can sing a role and someone who has the role in their voice.
Correct.
Those are two completely different things. And I didn't want to be going on and just getting by with it.
Yeah, I know that difference. Fortunately, in my case, I can only ever remember cancelling one show due to illness in my life, you know. But there have been other times where, like, I would have gladly handed it over. But because I could still sing it, even though I had rotten headache or, a toothache or stuff that happens.
Yeah,
I'm not after anyone's sympathy, right? I could still sing it almost on autopilot.
Yeah.
That's the sort of thing you've got to get to.
But that's where you want
to
get to.
You have to get like that. And so I keep saying to music theatre folks, it's about preservation.
Yeah.
Musical theatre singing, yes, it's about that you will occasionally have one of those nights as a performance where you go, oh, boy. Boy, I was on it tonight.
I'm amazing.
Well, don't know about that, but you'll have people saying to you, man, you went to some other places tonight.
Well, some people call it your A show and your B show.
Right.
I think it's safe. I think it's better to do your B show. Your B show shouldn't be less. It shouldn't be bad. That should be your I can do this eight shows a week.
Yes, I give that the 90% category.
Yeah.
And then anything above that is your A show, for want of a better term. And you just happen to be in good voice that night and it's working better. You can't help but go with it. That's a great feeling.
Within reason, obviously.
Within reason. Well, as you say, there are still people that are going to say, hang on a sec, we don't want that vocal trill on there.
Yeah.
Where did that come from? And why are you holding the note longer? So there are some restrictions.
Yeah.
And that's being respectful to the text as well, isn't it?
Yes.
To the author. And so that six practices a week you're doing, the three performances and whatnot, mm-hmm. must have taken your voice to a whole different level as a result.
Yeah, it did. I've always had quite a, what's the correct way of saying this? Quite a light sound.
Mm-hmm.
And that gave me so much more depth to my voice because yeah. I don't know. That wasn't even me trying to create that sound. It's just yeah. where it took it.
Yeah. Well, there's been a number of reasons for that. You know?
Yeah.
But the interesting thing is that you're able to have that discovery. That role is very tough. It's considered one of the most difficult ones in musical theatre.
Yeah, I would say that and probably the narrator in Joseph are, I think, two of the most difficult female roles.
Mm, without question.
Because
without
question. And it's more about stamina than...
Yeah.
Well, and range, actually.
There are other roles, like in Rent, they go through... They discard singers in that at a rate of knots.
Yeah.
You know, people who come in because they try to go for people who aren't musical theatre trained.
Yeah.
I was the coach on the Sydney production, which
is a long time ago. And then get them to do eight shows a week,
Then you get people, you know, I mean, they're rehearsing at 10 o'clock in the morning. Most of them have got a kind of rock and roll background. They've never even been out of bed at 10 o'clock in the morning, yeah. let alone, well, what do you mean I got to warm up? And what do you mean I got to be able to sing?
Mm-hmm.
And so they go through them at a rate of knots.
Yeah.
But, you know, it some of them get onto it, but it comes at a huge vocal cost, a show like that.
Yeah.
I'm just thrilled for you. I really am. I was so tickled pink when your mum told me that you were doing it. Sadly, I never got to see you in it, but, you know, who knows? Maybe it'll come around again.
It might come around again.
It might come around again. With regard to your vocal training,
mm-hmm.
so a lot of our viewers, they really want to know vocal tips. You know, they want to know things that folks do. Do you have a routine? Would you have a show day routine that you would go through?
Yeah. I had a specific Evita show day routine.
Yes, that's what I meant.
Yeah. I would do something different for other shows. It was all about tilt and, which I guess for Australians, we kind of have that naturally because we're quite twangy anyway.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Whereas the Brits, they sit further back in their voice. So they have to learn that.
Yes.
It was all about that. It was all about adding cry into your voice. Mm-hmm. I don't know if these are terms that are...
Well, they're pretty common, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, twang and cry. And then people just call them different things.
Yeah, so. And it was all about creating that sound for my voice, especially in all of the higher stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Because naturally, I want to pull back on the higher stuff and put more weight on the lower stuff because I'm not a low singer. But it was actually doing the opposite,
mm-hmm.
putting more weight on the higher stuff and putting less on the lower stuff because it didn't need it.
Mm-hmm.
It was more about the text than I am singing low.
Yes.
So, yeah, I would say it's about a 20 to 25 minute warm-up routine that I would do. And then I would sing Buenos Aires, which is mm-hmm. one of the first songs in the show that she sings. And then I would sing, what's it called? It's one of the songs that it's actually Che's song, and Ava just sings like the end part of it.
High Flying Adored.
Thank you.
Yeah.
High Flying Adored. Mm-hmm. Because that for me was one of the more difficult songs because it was all in my mix.
Yes.
Which I'm stronger when I'm singing in my mezzo range.
Mm.
I'm not really a mixer.
Mm.
And it was the transition between mezzo to soprano. It was right in the bridge of my voice, which
yes.
is not as strong as I would like it to be.
Yeah.
So I would always sing that song before going on stage.
It's interesting because what you've described through all of that is that you require a chest
mm-hmm.
and a mix and a strong head voice as well. So
yeah.
for one of it's unfortunate we give these things names because they
yeah.
they get confusing. But nonetheless, we've got to make some sort of reference point so that you require, you know, being able to registrate is the fancy term, whether we call it tilt or cry or weep or sob or
yeah.
there's all sorts of things that go on. So there's an affectation on the voice that
mm-hmm.
allows you to get into these different parts.
Yeah.
And once you know what those are, once you can experience those, but it's interesting that they're done through doing. Now, silly as that sounds, isn't it? You have to be put into the condition, for want of a better term, through
yeah.
a process of exercises or is that fair to say?
Well, I'm quite – everyone's different. I'm not a vocal coach, so I, like, take everything I say with a pinch of salt. Is that the right saying?
That'll do, yeah.
Yeah. So I'm quite muscle memory.
Yes.
I'm really good at remembering. It just is there.
Well, but that's what I'm referring to, but it's how you get there in the first
yeah.
place. That's really the trick in, and I use the word trick advisedly, that I'll, for example, in my studio, I'll give somebody a particular exercise that might be a pharyngeal type exercise or something like that. I don't need to explain to them all the mechanics of it, but once they go into that spot, you see their eyes go, that's what that feels like. Yeah. And then, of course, you've got to encourage that person through the 25-minute warm-up or whatever it is to go back to that place because as musicians, because a lot of singers don't consider themselves musicians, but we are, you know. So if somebody can make the pitch, that seems to be the primary goal, but not in musical theatre. You have to make the pitch, of course, but you also have to stay in character
and create the right sound.
And have the durability to do 8 shows a week. And so there's a combination of factors. And I think I said earlier that musical theatre, it's not only about stamina, it's about preservation.
Yeah.
Being able to get that voice in that spot or close to that spot every time.
I've always been really lucky because I always started with quite technical training.
Mm.
Whereas a lot of singers these days, and there's nothing wrong with this, but they start with, like, pop is so popular at the moment. That's why it's called pop.
Yes, there it is.
And there's not always a lot of technique to pop.
No, far from it.
Whereas I started with technique and then learnt pop.
Yes.
So even though now I would say most of the work I do vocally is pop, I still approach it from technique.
Yes, of course.
Which, I mean, I'll never be a rock singer. Because right. I sound too clean to be a rock singer.
Yes, I understand what you mean.
And, you know, that, I guess, could be a negative to starting that way. But in saying that, there is a technique to rock as well, so.
Without question, there are some great pop singers that have been trained.
Yeah.
But the really cool part about it, well, my mentor, Seth Riggs, used to say, you want to study technique so as not to have the technique show.
Yes.
And that's really what it comes down to. So probably the best
I had
example,
to learn that. Though.
Yes, one of the best examples we've got of that is Stevie Wonder had extensive vocal training after he had surgery when he was 17 or 18. He had nodules removed and his story is quite well known. And he didn't go to learn how to sing musically. I mean, forget it. The guy's everything, right? But muscularly, he had to learn how to use his voice differently.
Yeah.
To the best of my knowledge, since then, and that would be the 1960s or so, he's not had any vocal problems. Mm. To my knowledge, he's never cancelled a concert or anything like that. And when you see him on TV, you see him on those award shows, and you have a few guests on before, and you think, oh, the sound must be bad or something. And then he comes on and brains it. You go, well, maybe not. Maybe the sound's the same for everybody. So at that point, there are many, many, many people, many more, if that's the right way to put it, than people would be aware of, like really, really well-known singers who've had training.
Yeah,
they don't even talk about it. Frank Sinatra had training.
Yeah.
You know, and in fact produced a singing book.
Most people have, even if they didn't start with training, once they become a celebrity, for lack of a better term, they then get training because they want to be able to sustain their concerts or, Adele.
Yes.
Like she hadn't had training when she started and then realized, actually, this is quite difficult to do. So then sourced out vocal training.
Well, we just talked about Jeremy before, and I can remember I was in London 10, 12 or so years ago, and he was going on for his singing lesson. Now, prior to that, he used to make jokes with me and say, oh, you singing teachers, you take, I think he used to say, you take advantage of people's anxiety or whatnot. And I said, that's a good idea. We should start doing that.
Yeah.
But he wasn't anti-singing teacher, but he certainly wasn't doing it. Now, in between that and the next time I heard him sing, that voice had changed remarkably.
Yeah.
And I know that he went and got the right kind of coaching. But he told me that he was getting feedback from auditions. It wasn't that people didn't think he could sing. They didn't like the sound. There's a certain sound that I've noticed in musical theatre. It's changed.
Yeah.
If I was to listen to a recording of you doing Evita and then go and listen to Patti LuPone doing it from the 80s, it's a different sound.
Yes, correct.
And it's a little bit more brassy now. It's slightly more, and I say not poppy as in licky, but as in pop licks.
Yeah.
It's got a more pop type sound to it.
Yeah.
Than any other
mine
time.
Was very poppy.
I'm sure. And so this is how it's changed a lot, so much. Coaches have to be aware of that and how to get that out of folks and whatnot. And, you know, it takes time.
I always say this about singing teachers is that it's such a personal thing.
Mm.
Like one singing teacher that's great for me might not be great for someone else.
Very true.
Because it's all about how can you get the person to do the right thing. And the way that one person says it just might not make sense to someone.
Mm, I agree. On that tender note, we'll have a little break in. We'll come back and we'll just chat about what's happening next for you.
Mm.
We'll be back in just a moment.
You're tuned in to Live at Leigh's Place, where we talk to singers about singing stuff. Proudly presented by VocalMastery.com, where there's never been a better time to become a great singer.
And we're back talking with my good friend Kellie Gnauck about her fantastic career at such a young age already. I wonder if you've got some advice for young singers. They don't have to be young, maybe not so young, but people that are, you know, they're looking at you and going, wow, you know, small town girl. I mean, it sounds a bit American, I know, but girl from a small town, did her studies.
Sounds like a Journey song.
Just a small town. I think that's been written already.
Oh.
But to wind up performing, and I'm not doing this to embarrass you because, I mean, I'm enormously proud of you and I hope you know that.
Thank you.
To wind up in the West End and be in a major show is an extraordinary thing to be able to do. I mean, this is no other way to put it. And there are many, many people who would be hopeful of doing a similar thing.
So I mean, I'm hopeful of doing it as well.
Right.
I'd like to continue.
Or continuing to do it. Yes, I understand. Yeah. Tell us what you would advise a young person who's thinking, I'd like to have a go at that.
I feel like the best thing I can say is you just have to put yourself out there. You just have to make yourself open to as many opportunities as you can. The training aspect of it, that goes without saying, that is something you should be doing anyway.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not all about the training. You could be the best singer in the room and still not get the job. It's not about that. There's so much more to it. It's, if you want to do theatre and you're an amazing singer, go get your dance training.
Mm.
Do your acting classes. Don't just do theatre acting. Do screen acting. Do as many different things as you can, because you learn something, even if it's just something little, you can take something away from that. And even in doing that, you're meeting new people, and a lot of the industry is who you know.
It's networking, isn't
which
it?
Which is both a good and a bad thing.
Yeah.
But yeah, you just got to put yourself out there. It's right place, right time.
Mm-hmm.
Sometimes that's all it is.
Sometimes that's true, yeah. But turning up with no skills is not going to help.
No, be prepared. Don't, like, you can't wing it.
Yeah.
Although I like to wing things every now and then.
Sure.
That's not going to give you the best chance.
Mm-hmm.
Don't over rehearse things, because then you become robotic. You have to want to do it. You can't be doing it because you think it's the right thing to do. You might get somewhere from that, but I don't think that that's the way to, you know, go into something. You have to be. I don't think I've ever been the most talented person in the room, but I've been the most passionate person in the room.
Right,
I've worked harder than everyone else.
I hear a lot of people say, as part of their story, they'll go, oh, it's not that I think I'm the best singer in the world, which I always find an extraordinary statement for people to make.
Well, who's the best?
Well, exactly. Then where was that competition? And I know that it's just a figure of speech.
It's so subjective.
And then some, because, I mean, try and argue with someone who's a Bob Dylan fan that Pavarotti is a better singer.
Yeah.
It just can't possibly work. But we do know that in theatre, there are requirements for the role.
Yeah, there's,
I mean,
so
I'm,
many variables.
I'm not going to go and play a 25-year-old Italian lead role. It's just not going to happen. I mean, the reality is there, because physically I'm not right for it.
I've missed out on jobs because I'm too tall.
Right.
Or my face hasn't been right for it.
Whatever,
like,
that means,
what does that mean?
I've no idea. It's a crazy thing. But the heartbreaking thing for folks, they go to auditions and they rarely get that feedback. And so if they're left to their own imagination as to what went wrong, and, you know, that brings feelings of disappointment, even to the point of inadequacies and going, oh, you know, what am I kidding myself?
It's not the most sensitive thing to say, but you have to get over that. Like, you've got to have a tough skin.
Yep.
I've been to so many auditions and not heard anything. I've gotten to finals and not heard anything, and realized I didn't get the job when the casting came out. And I went, well, my name's not on there, so
Guess I didn't get that. Yes.
When you're starting out, you're not going to get that kind of feedback.
No.
When you get to a certain level, and I don't necessarily agree with that. I think when you get to the finals for a show, you should get an answer.
Mm.
You should be able to ask, oh, well, you know, why didn't I get the part?
Right.
And, like, that doesn't take a lot of time to write an email and say, we thought you were great, but you were too young or whatever.
Yeah, and dare they put in, we'd like to recommend that you do this.
Yeah.
We'd like to recommend that you maybe work on this part of your dancing or this part of your singing.
Yeah.
And so that you could go to a specialist in that area and say, okay, I need to get this part,
yeah,
you know, going.
But unfortunately, that's not always, you're not always going to get that. You can't expect to receive that.
And what's coming up for you in the future? You're going back to London tomorrow?
Tomorrow night, yes. I go back. I am going back because I have a contract starting up mid-May for School of Rock, which I assume you know.
Yes, I know very
There was a film of it with Jack Black.
Yes.
So I'll be starting that. It's only 4.5 months, the contract.
Right.
So that's exciting.
Are you playing the...
So there's two female roles, really. It's about the kids.
Mistress, I think.
The other one.
Right.
Yeah. It's very kid-heavy, that show.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
I can, well, it's probably nothing to do with your, but I can now announce that one of my students has just got the lead role of Summer in the Australian production.
Amazing.
But by the time this podcast comes out, it's announced on Wednesday.
Oh, okay.
So we're safe.
We're safe.
Right? So I'm not breaking any laws.
That's exciting.
She's very talented, and they're going to South Korea first. To start with, if you can believe that.
She'll be on my tour.
Oh, you're on that one?
We're doing South Korea.
Ah, right. So there goes. It's Billy Rose Robertson.
She's
fantastic. I'll show you a photo of it. She is dynamite.
Hooray. What a small world.
Oh, that.
I was about to say, I think we have Australian kids.
Yeah, yeah. And so they're going to South Korea first, as you well know. And then those same kids are coming back and working in Sydney.
Oh, wow.
Oh, I'm thrilled to bits. I can't wait to.
So all the adults are from. Most of them were cast in London, but I think we've actually got the Broadway, whoever the lead guy is. What's he called?
Oh, the Jack Black character.
Dewey. Something.
Yes, right. Yeah.
So I think we've got the Broadway Dewey, Australian kids, and then British, everyone else.
There you go.
Yeah.
Well, that's a small world.
That's exciting.
Well, I'll be able to keep an eye on you, and vice versa.
Yeah.
There you go.
So I'm doing that, and then I also do loads of presenting and commercial work and stuff like that. So
yeah, you got to do what you got to do, right, in between.
Yeah.
Look, and finally, one of the most asked questions we get for our email of this is people want to know about handling, for want of a better term, performer's anxiety and nerves and all that sort of stuff. You got some advice you can offer there?
I think you need to learn how to, everyone, again, is different.
Mm-hmm.
It's a personal thing with what works best for you for dealing with it. For me, the best thing I learned, when I was first out of college, I was so desperate for a job. I'd walk into a room and you can smell the desperation.
Mm.
It's, please give me this job. I just want to be right. Whereas now I walk into an audition and I go, do you know what? This is what I can do. I'd love if you liked it. If you don't, there's nothing I can do. Like, you're either going to like me or you're not. I'm either going to be right or I'm not. I can spend all the time in the world outside of this working on my singing, working on my acting. But when it comes down to it, they're either going to like you or they're not.
Right.
You just have to be confident within yourself.
That's that part. But what about then when you do get the role and you're preparing and there's, you know, there's anticipation of it coming up? And I mean, you kind of fortunately got thrust on as Evita.
Yeah.
And probably
I feel like I've had the worst of it.
Didn't have too much time to even worry about being nervous at that point.
Yeah.
But there have been other things where I'm sure you've been... I like to call it toey, you know what I mean? Like, toey is a bit of an Australian thing. I'm keen to get on because I always say there's two types of nervousness. One is, oh my God, I haven't prepared properly.
Yeah.
That's the one you don't want, right?
Yes.
The other one is that you really care and you want to do a great job. And but the second one only comes with experience.
Yeah.
It really does. You know, if you're in your first show and you're green, you really don't know what's going on. Then I guess you've got to trust the people around you to kind of guide you through, haven't you?
Yeah. I sounds wanky, but just breathe. Like, you just have to,
great advice.
In whatever works best for you, keep yourself as calm as you can. Adrenaline will do a lot for you. And I think adrenaline is actually a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't have any adrenaline, it's almost boring.
Right.
You don't want to see someone on stage giving a half-assed performance.
No.
So I think that kind of nerves is actually helpful.
Mm.
But it's when... it's like crippling nerves that you need to deal with, whether it's breathing, whether it's meditating, I guess it's kind of the same thing. I don't know. I don't know if I've really struggled with that. So I don't know.
I'm pleased to say I haven't either. But, and I think if you're having that kind of nervousness, you might be in the wrong profession.
Yeah.
You might be.
For me,
if it's repeated sort of thing.
I do worse shows when I'm comfortable. My best shows are when I am a little bit nervous.
Yes.
When I get comfortable, that's when my brain turns off and I forget lines or something.
Mm. Yes, and that'll wake you up very quickly.
That will very quickly wake you up on stage.
Oh, I just did that in front of 2,000 people.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, look, I've said it before. I'm so proud of you. I'm so glad that you've come and spent this bit of time with me. I know you're very, very busy. I feel very honoured to have you here, and I am absolutely thrilled for your success. I know it's going to be continued.
Hopefully.
I'm tickled pink about the life that you've carved out for yourself there and all the things that you're doing. And look, there's really only one thing left for us to do, and that is let's go and have a sing.
Singing!
Yay!
Hooray!
Thank you very much. Tell me something, girl. Are you happy in this modern world? Or do you need more? Is there something else you're searching for? I'm falling. In all the good times I find myself longing for change. And in the bad times I fear myself.
Tell me something, boy. Aren't you tired trying to fill that void? Or do you need more? Keeping it so hardcore, I'm falling. In all the good times I find myself longing for change. And in the bad times I fear myself. I'm off the deep end, watch as I dive in. Shallow, in the shallow, in the shallow, we're far from the shallow now.